So I want to ask you to imagine, picture something for me. So if you will, if you're comfortable, I'd ask you to close your eyes. You're driving home from visiting a friend's house. The road is what you see in front of you. It's late at night. You turn a corner and you see a deer. And almost without thinking, you swerve to the right. There's a telephone pole in front of you. And what happens from then is kind of this blur. The blur involves you remembering being transported to a hospital, remembering going in and out of one test or another test. You kind of slowly come to and you realize that you can't move. Your arms don't work. Your nose itches and you can't reach up to touch it. Go ahead and open your eyes. Doctors come in to see you. You're in a fog half the time. They tell you that you've had a spinal cord injury. And what that means is that your spinal cord has been severed or damaged around the area of the neck, and your arms don't follow the commands that your brain is putting out. They tell you that yours is complete and the chances of recovery are low to none. They try to give you hope. And eventually they tell you that you're doing well enough that the fog will lift, the pain will be gone, and that you can go to a rehabilitation facility where they'll work on getting you to be more independent. You go to the rehab facility, meet a new team of people, and a young researcher walks into the room and says, "Hey, I want you to be in a research study." The research study is about the most amazing piece of assistive technology, a technology to help you be more independent. And I want you to be part of this study that's going to teach us the value of this amazing piece of assistive technology. They bring a wheelchair into the room, and they ask you if you want to be part of the study. And probably what you'll say is, no. I know that because that was one of the first research studies I tried to do. And the reason you'll say no is that you've seen the TV shows where the person just worked hard enough and what they tell you is they triumphed over their disease and they were able to walk out of the hospital. And you're going to be one of those people. You're going to work hard enough that you don't need the wheelchair. That's going to be you. Let me tell you about a study that we did. We asked 100 people with spinal cord injury who were living in the community about what keeps them from participating in daily life. What is it that prevents them from going out? And it was a multiple choice. We listed choices for them. The choices were, two of the choices were the wheelchair, and another choice was their paralysis. Those were the top two choices people listed. And when they listed the number one choice by far was that the wheelchair kept them from going out, not the fact that they couldn't move their legs. There's a couple of interesting perspectives on that. I saw that study and I felt great and bad at the same time. I felt great because when I can't see out of my glasses, it's because they're blurry. It's not because I have bad eyes. And the act of getting past a spinal cord injury, we all have bad things that happen to us. The act of recovery, the mental act of recovery, right, is accepting your disability. And then what it becomes is about the technology. And what they're saying to me was, this technology that you're doing research on stinks. Doesn't work like we want it to. I'll tell you another story. We again polled people, now it's in the thousands with spinal cord injury, and we said, tell us how your wheelchair works for you, tell us how often it breaks down. And in a 6-month period of time, the wheelchair that they were using broke down. 50% of the people had a wheelchair failure in that 6-month period of time. Stop working, often stranding them, injuring them. Why is the wheel, and so, in my mind, that explains this. The wheelchair is what's keeping me from doing more. We have the technology to build wheelchairs that will climb stairs, go through sand, won't break down. And everybody who uses a wheelchair knows that. And they're frustrated by the technology. And why does that exist? Well, to some degree, it's a social political problem. Wheelchairs are paid a certain amount. Most payers in the United States will pay a certain amount for a power wheelchair. So what the engineering constraint becomes is engineering for cost. It's not about making the wheelchair that makes you the most independent. It's about making the wheelchair at the lowest cost that makes you the most independent. And that automatically constrains the system. So I want to tell you about another set of research I had the pleasure to be involved with. Andy Schwartz and Doug Weber, two brilliant neuroscientists at the University of Pittsburgh, and I were meeting. They wanted to talk to me about working with people with spinal cord injury because Andy Schwartz had done this amazing thing. He had gotten a monkey to feed itself using a robotic arm and nothing but the monkey's thoughts. So he had implanted a chip into the brain of a monkey. He was able to record the electrical signal from the monkey's brain, interpret that signal, and have it control a robotic arm. So an important concept here in control and when you think about movement is degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom of movement. So if you have one degree of freedom, you can move back, you can control something that's moving back and forth along a line. If you have two, you can actually control a mouse pad, right? You can move up, down, left, right, but you're constrained to one plane. And if you have 3 degrees of freedom, you can reach in space. That's almost the magic number, right? If you get to 4, you can reach and grasp. With 7 degrees of freedom, you can move your wrist in any direction, reach and grasp. And as you get into 10 degrees of freedom and more, you can actually manipulate things with the hand. Our arm probably can be controlled with 14 degrees of freedom. And he had gotten a monkey to get above 4 degrees of freedom, which nobody else had done. And he said to me, boy, if we could implant a chip in a human, we could get him to play the piano. Someone with a spinal cord injury. What does that chip look like? Well, it's about the size, a little bit bigger than the eraser on the tip of a pencil. It has 100 tiny pins on it, and the tiny pins get pushed down during the operative procedure using that plunger that you can see on the screen into the brain, and then those pins are able to record the signal. My job, what they trusted me with in the OR, was not being part of the sterile field, being a little bit removed from the table, hitting the button that had that plunger push it in. The brain is pulsating, and they wanted me to do it when the brain was lifted as high as it was. And this is what the brain looks like. Who we are, if you see the structure around that plunger, is determined by this white matter with blood vessels running through it. Now let me tell you a little bit how we get to this level of control. So it turns out that when we move our arms, when I move my arm up here back and forth like this, there are nerves in your brain, there are cells in your brain that fire. And they fire at a different rate depending on which direction I move in. They're directionally tuned. And they fire faster if I move faster. And so what we did was we worked hard with the regulatory bodies and we found some amazing people who were willing to volunteer to have neurosurgery. And we would have them sit in front of a robotic arm, watch the arm move while we record the signals from the brain. And use that, we built a decoder that would say, hey, when they're moving this direction or when they're grasping, this is what the brain is doing. And then we would just tell the person who participated, Jan, there's her name, that she should just think about moving, and then that would enable her to control the arm. So what I'll show you is a clip of her in her talk related to controlling this arm. And remember, as you're watching this, the degrees of freedom, watch the movement, and she's doing this with nothing but her thoughts.
I'm here, as I've been through the whole experiment, to further push the science. I'm here because future generations of quadriplegics, paraplegics, and amputees will benefit from this, long after all of our names have been forgotten and science will live on. My goal is to feed myself chocolate. And I did that today. I fed myself chocolate. I'm excited to think that our work here in the lab will inspire more people to come forward and for the work to continue.
Pretty amazing, right? We wrote this up. It was accepted into a paper. 60 Minutes had followed Andy Schwartz's career for a while, and they asked to be there. In fact, they were in the OR while we were doing the surgery. My other job was to keep the cameraman away from the sterile field. Jen Collinger led that study, wrote the paper up, and the journal and 60 Minutes talked to each other and said, we need to do this all at one time. We need to make a splash. All right, so on one day, there was a press conference at UPMC and at the University of Pittsburgh. There were camera crews from all over the place. There was a 60 Minutes story. This was the conference was on Monday morning. The 60 Minutes story was on Sunday night, as they always are. And the publicity was unbelievable. I had people calling me from all over the world, wanting to do interviews, wanting to have me on television. Heady stuff and amazing stuff. But there's a part of me as a physician, not the bioengineer part of me, that thought about how many people I had helped with this brain-computer interface research. And the answer to that question is no one. Right? The participant in this study had to have the electrodes explanted at some point. And even when they were implanted, the only time she could do these activities was when she was in our lab. I had done numerous studies on wheelchairs and nobody called me. Not one person. And I want you to picture yourself now, and you're back in this hospital bed. You've kicked the researcher out of the room, and the physical therapist comes in next and says, you know, stupid research study anyway, but you do really need to learn how to drive this wheelchair, how to work with this technology. It's how you're going to get home. But the night before, you got a phone call from a friend. And the phone call from the friend was, did you see the 60 Minutes story? Right? There's a guy out there with putting chips in someone's brain. There's a team of researchers. They can get someone to control a robotic arm with nothing but their thoughts. It's only a matter of time. And if it's not about the robotic arm, maybe it's about an exoskeleton you saw where, like Iron Man, they're able to put a suit on and walk again. Or maybe it's about stem cells. We can just inject some stem cells into the spinal cord and we will cure paralysis. And they tell you that. And what I worry about with that is that you say, I don't need to learn how to use this wheelchair. The cure, exoskeletons, brain-computer interfaces, they're 5 years away, maybe. 5 years, and we'll get back to that in a second. I want to tell you about one last research study. So we did a research study where we followed people who were in rehab, and we looked at when they left the rehab hospital, were they walking? People with spinal cord injury. So if you have enough muscle strength left, you can walk, right? It's a matter of how much. If you have a complete injury, then you're not going to walk out of the hospital. We followed people. You can, though, even with a complete injury, you could support yourself with a walker and really lifting yourself with your arms. And what we said is, let's look at different groups. Let's look at a group of people who walked out of the hospital, and then a year later, let's see what they're doing. So a group of people who walked out of the hospital, and a year later were using a wheelchair. And we compared them to all others, including people who used a wheelchair when they left and were using a wheelchair a year later. And that group of people who walked out of the hospital and were using a wheelchair a year later had more pain, more depression, were much less likely to be participating in society. So this fear of this arrest in the recovery process seems like it might be real. You know, and at the same time, I'm getting the question, when can we implant this in a patient? And the email from the mom with a kid who has cerebral palsy saying, is there a chip for my son with cerebral palsy? I really want him to be able to move normally again. And I worry about the impact that the research that I now do is having on the populace out there that would want so desperately to have that quick cure. You know, and stem cells are a case in point. When I was a medical student 30 years ago, stem cells were 5 years away from leading to a cure. And for the past 30 years, they've been 5 years away. It's the perfect length of time, because what happens when you get asked that question, right? I have to worry about the funding of my research projects. And if I say, oh, sure, we're going to cure spinal cord injury, we're going to cure it in 100 years, no one wants to fund me. Fascinatingly enough, if I propose a research study that wants to help people tomorrow because of wheelchairs, I can make a better wheelchair, they're saying, what's new under the sun in wheelchairs? Haven't you been working on that for 30 years? So there's this knife edge there, and I, you know, need to be really clear about something. I'm really proud of the brain computer interface work. It's amazing stuff. It has to continue. The stem cell work has to continue. The exoskeletal work has to continue, right? There is hope for the cure. There is hope that we can take someone with a spinal cord injury or an amputation and give them this new freedom. But what we have to be careful about is the knife edge between hype and hope. If I hype it too much, then someone buys in and they get stuck and keep thinking, I'm just going to wait till someone cures me. I don't really need to learn how to use that wheelchair. If we don't hype it enough, we don't get funding. And in the meantime, we need to work on the funding for the technology that helps us move mobility, the wheelchair, today. Now, I have to tell you that when I give this talk, sometimes, you know, I feel this combination of pride in what the teams I've been a part of have accomplished, and some concern about where we're going in the future. But I look out at this University of Pittsburgh students who got out of bed this morning and decided to spend a day listening to people talk. And I think about the artists in the room who need to be able to help us express this, right? Art is this wonderful way of recovering from a spinal cord injury. And I think about the city planners and the political science majors and the engineers in the room. And there's no doubt in my mind that you guys can solve this problem, and we can walk that edge. We can give people hope, and we can help them today. Thank you.